starting by just wanted to mention a couple of acronyms that I'll use, and so I'm talking about the LANDFIRE Data Access Tool, and I refer to it as LFDAT for short. And then on that first slide, toward the bottom there, the second organization listed is the National Interagency Fuels, Fire, and Vegetation Technology Transfer. And they go by the acronym of NIFTY. And NIFTY works closely with LANDFIRE to provide technology transfer as well as software development and support, including support for LFDAT. So we just wanted to mention those acronyms that I might use throughout the talk here a bit. Okay, and so today I'm going to give just a very brief overview of the LANDFIRE data products, describe the LANDFIRE data distribution site, and then I will describe, spend most of the time describing features of LFDAT and going through a software, a demo of the software. Okay, so LANDFIRE spatial data is produced wall-to-wall for all lands at 30-meter resolution using a standardized methodology across the entire U.S., and the products include terrain layers, elevation, slope, and aspect, vegetation layers that include existing vegetation type, canopy cover, canopy height, and two different versions of potential vegetation. There are several fuel layers, including fire behavior fuel models, canopy fuels, fuel bed, and fuel loading layers. And importantly, these include all the layers needed, all the fuel layers needed to run several fire simulation models like Farsight and others. There are fire regime layers that describe things like historical fire frequency and fire severity patterns. Disturbances have also been mapped for the years 99 through 2008. And these include both natural disturbances and management activities, along with the disturbance severity. And so at this point, the vegetation and fuel products have been produced for two time periods. The first set of products was originally produced for a circa 2001 period, and this version is referred to as LANDFIRE National. And then an update project was started called Refresh, and it resulted in some modifications and improvements to the original 2001 data, and then updating those layers to a circa 2008 period. So you can find a lot more detailed information about the specific products on landfire.gov. And I did want to just highlight one page from landfire.gov that I think is particularly helpful. I'm not sure if the text comes through that great on this slide. It's not all that important, but once you're on landfire.gov, the navigation is pretty straightforward. And over on the left there's a section for data products, and under that is a link to the version comparison page. This page gives a good summary of the different versions of the data, and it highlights differences between the versions, describes the time periods, has some key points about the methodology, and there's also a version numbering scheme. So the original national data is a 1.0 version, and then the refresh versions have version numbers like 1.05, 1.1. And so sometimes in acquiring data and working with the data, the version numbers come up, and it's kind of helpful to have this reference to, well, exactly what time period is that, and that kind of thing. And then there are links off of this page to more detailed information about the products and methods. Okay, so also on landfire.gov, I believe on every page of the site, there is this icon at the top, which is a link to the data distribution site. And data distribution for LANDFIRE is hosted by USGS, and this site, the data distribution site, provides information on data status in terms of a map showing areas where new data have been added or updates have been made, And then it provides a seamless data server for acquiring the data. And so what this is an interactive map where you can zoom in and pan around to find an area of interest. And then you can click and drag a box on the screen to define an extent rectangle that you would like to acquire data for. And at that point, the server will clip out just that section of data that you request. It'll package it as a set of raster files and the metadata for that raster, compress those into a zip file, and make that available for download. So for each different layer type that you were interested in, you would get a zip file containing raster data and metadata. And this is a fully functional site. It's a great way to obtain the data. It all works through a web browser interface, so there's no requirement to use ArcMap. And so it is a good place to go and get the data. So basically, the software that I'm going to describe is an alternative to the data distribution site, or at least it's an alternative for users of ArcMap. And it allows you to define the extent rectangle and interact with the data distribution site from within ArcMap directly instead of using the web browser interface. And it also provides some richer functionality since we can make use of the full capabilities in Arc. And I have just listed here the current versions of LFDAT that are available. There's an LFDAT 2.3 for ArcMap 9, and then we've just newly completed an LFDAT 2.4 for ArcMap 10. And as I get into the software demo, I'm going to show you how you could go find these and download them for installation. LFDAT 2.4 for ArcMap 10 is not up available for download yet, but it will be very shortly, possibly as early as tomorrow. So that version will be coming. So just kind of to summarize some of the features that I'll look at in the demo. Again, LFDAT allows you to define the spatial extent you're interested in and download the data directly from within ArcMap. You can also save those spatial extents for later reuse. So if you needed to come back later and acquire more data and you wanted it for the exact same extent, you can save that, reuse it later. And then once you downloaded these zip files, so you're typically getting one zip file containing raster data for each layer you're interested in, you can just download all of those zip files into a single folder, and then LFDAT will process them automatically. It'll process the zip files in a way that can save a lot of time and bundle some convenient processing steps into a single batch. So that you can get to the point of having the raster data set up and ready for analysis pretty quickly and easily. So that involves, again, process any number of layers, and you could even mix in different spatial extents if you needed to into a single batch. It will unzip each of those files. Optionally, it could reproject the data into a different coordinate system if you needed to do that. It could also optionally convert the data into another raster format if needed. And then this next point here, it could merge multi-piece extents if needed. I'm going to temporarily go forward one slide and then come back to this to explain what I mean. If often project areas aren't that large and your data are going to easily fit into a single zip file download, but some people will end up working with really large extents, like say a large state or a multi-state area region. In that case, the server is going to usually split the download into multiple pieces. So what I'm showing here in this graphic, if you maybe were trying to get a big chunk of the Southwest, the server might split that into four or possibly more different pieces. So you would get four zip files instead of a single zip file containing the data for any particular layer. And if what you wanted was to have just one big raster for that layer, you would have to unzip each one of those individually and then go through a merge operation to put them back together. So LFDAT will automatically identify zip files that are pieces of a larger contiguous extent from a given layer and then merge those into a single raster during this processing. It'll assign some friendly file names to the output rasters, identifying the layer that it is. And then finally, it will reattach attributes, at least if you're working with ARC grid format. So a lot of these steps, if we're doing them manually, if we were doing a reproject or a merge, ARC would tend to leave our attribute table off in the output, and you'd have to come back and have that as another manual step. So LFDAT automates that at the end of the processing. It attaches the attribute table back to the ARC grid. So that's kind of the main functionality, which is download and then simplify, automate the processing to make it quick and easy. And then there are a few other kind of miscellaneous utilities, related utilities within LFDAT. Primarily dealing with LCP files. So LCP, or landscape file, is a specialized raster format used by programs like Farsight and others that do fire simulations. It's a multi-band raster format that contains the different terrain and fuel layers all combined into a single raster file. So LFDAT has the capability to build LCP files from the individual grids that make it up. And then it can also has a function to take an LCP file and deconstruct it back into the individual grids, writing them out as, an ARC grid format. And then there's another utility there that does that attribute attaching I mentioned. So if you end up doing some processing and have lost the attributes or don't have the attribute table attached to the grid, assuming you still have the table in like a DBF format, it would do the join and attach it to the grid for you. Okay, so at this point, I'm going to switch over and start the demo unless there's any questions at this point. Give me 1 second here. I'm going to share an application. Okay, so hopefully you now see an Internet Explorer window.
Yeah, I see it, Chris.
Okay. So I'll first talk about getting LFDAT. Getting it downloaded so that you can install it on your computer. Generally, the best place to start there is landfire.gov. If you use Google for search, if you just search Landfire, it comes up as the first hit. And also underneath the main link to the home page, there are some sub pages there that it links to, and usually the Landfire data access tool comes up as a search result that you can link directly to. If we follow that link, it will take us to the landfire.gov page about the tool. It gives a description of what the tool does, and then over on the right side here, there is a link to the download page. And I'm just going to back up for 1 second and assume that instead we just started out on the home page of landfire.gov. And over on the right-hand side of that page, there is a link kind of a little more than halfway down the page on the right that says helpful tools to assist users of Landfire data. If we follow that link, there's a list of different tools and resources, and the first one listed is LFDAT. And over to the right-hand side, there is a link to that page we saw previously, which has a description of the tool. And then there's also another link directly to the download page. I'm going to go to it. So LFDAT is hosted and distributed by Nifty, and so it's on the Nifty tools and user documents page. So there's several different tools being distributed here. So we'll have to scroll down and find LFDAT about halfway down the page. And you'll see that there are two entries for it. The first one here, there was a heading up above that said use this list of tools for ART map 9.2 and 9.3. So this is the 9 version of LFDAT. And there are some links over on the right. The one that just says LFDAT would allow you to download the installation package. There's a link to the user's guide that's also contained in the installation package. And then down below here, there's a section that starts use these tools with ART 10. These are the ART 10 versions of the tools. So if you're using ART 10, you could download LFDAT 2.3 for it. And again, we have a 2.4 finalized. And it will be up on this site shortly. And a little bit later in the demo, I'll show you some ways that you can kind of easily monitor updates to versions and find out when there are new releases and that kind of thing. But the Nifty page is really the official download page for LFDAT. This is the place to go get it. And the latest versions will always be here as they're released. Okay, so I won't go through the installation. You would get a zip file that contains a Windows installer and some documentation in there, a user guide. I would encourage you to read through the documentation before installing it the first time. But generally, installation is pretty quick and easy. You will need administrative access on the computer to install it, but it usually goes smoothly and it's quick. Should not be a problem. So from here, I'm going to leave Internet Explorer. And I'm going to now switch over to ArtMap. Okay, so is that okay, Xander? We have an ArcMap window now?
Yeah, looks good to me.
Looks good here, Chris.
Okay, so assuming that you've acquired the tool and gotten it installed, you should see the toolbar appear in ArcMap. If you don't see it after the first time you install it, you may have to turn on the toolbar, which would just be right-click some blank area up on the menu toolbar area, scroll down to LANDFIRE Data Access Tool in the list, and turn it on. And then we should have a toolbar. So I'm just going to go through some of the functionality of buttons on the toolbar. And I'm going to start with this button all the way on the right that has a paperclip icon. It's an About button. And if you click it, you get an About form that gives you some information about the LFDAT that you have installed. It's going to tell you the version. There are a few useful hyperlinks here, including a link to the data distribution site. There's also a link to the user guide and documentation. Down toward the bottom here, you'll notice that there's an email address for the help desk at LANDFIRE. This will be the primary place to obtain support if you have issues, problems, questions. Email the help desk, and we usually try to get back to you as possible. And then another thing I want to talk about here a little bit is this button in the middle called Check for Updates. So if I click that, I get this web update function. And there are parts of this are actually not working right now, but part of it works really well and is pretty important. So let me explain that. At the top here, the application version, that's just talking about the tool itself, the version that's installed. And you'll notice that it says the latest available version is 2.2, and that's not true. So this is currently not working. It has to do with some problems we encountered when ART 10 came along, and we just didn't build enough logic into this thing to support a web update of ART 9 and ART 10 simultaneously. think this functionality will come back in the near future, but it will probably just support ARC 10 versions going forward. But right now this doesn't work, and all it really did was download that installation package for you. You still had to install it manually at that point, so it's not that much different than just going to the nifty download page to get the application. But we're going to try to have this thing working again before long. And then the thing that does work and is kind of important is in the center here, there is a section for database versions, and in particular the configuration database. We have a LFDAT uses a configuration database that stores lookup tables that contain information that it needs to interact with the data distribution site, and also information that it needs to metadata and that kind of thing that it needs to do the automated processing. So as LANDFIRE adds new data, or as changes are made to the data formats or whatever on the data distribution site, we need to update those lookup tables and then keep them current in the instance of LFDAT that you're using. So in a second I'll show you a way to find out pretty easily when we have these updates available, but it's a good idea to check these. And the main reason for using this web update is to update the configuration database. Mine's already up to date, so the update button is grayed out. If I was behind a version and needed an update, I would be able to click the update button, and it usually just takes a few seconds. It'll download it and give you a message saying that it's been updated successfully, and it'll show you the new version number. Those updates happen anywhere from, you know, they could be a couple of months. Sometimes, you know, we may go 2 or 3 months without an update. But usually when they come out, they can be important. It's kind of important to keep that thing up to date. Okay, so I'm going to back out of here. Now I'm going to go now over to the left-hand side of the toolbar and just kind of go through this functionality. This first button here that says Data Status will give you a drop-down with choices for CONUS, Conterminous US, Alaska and Hawaii. And what these buttons will do is add a layer to ArcMap. I'll just do that now. And these polygons with the numbers in it are map zones, LANDFIRE map zones. And so LANDFIRE produces the data by map zone and then makes data available incrementally by groups of map zones referred to as geographic areas. So when LANDFIRE is in the middle of an update phase, data are becoming available incrementally over a period of maybe just a few months as it's produced. So this isn't very useful right now because all the data are available everywhere, so it's not telling you very much. If we get into another update cycle for the 2010 update, for example, you could go here and see that, okay, you know, new data has been added for the Southwest geo area. You could tell that it's now available, and that the symbology for those map zones would indicate that new data are available. People probably don't need these map zones very often, but as it is now, you know, if you ever needed to know what the LANDFIRE map zones were or have a polygon layer for it, it's kind of a quick and easy way to get to the map zone layer. But other than that, it would become useful again when LANDFIRE is in the process of updating the next round of data. Now I'm going to switch and open a project. So here I'll talk about just kind of what the typical workflow would be if you were interested in acquiring some LANDFIRE data for a particular area and getting it processed into rasters for analysis. So I've just got this is a layer of fire behavior fuel models for an area around Missoula, Montana. But this could be anything. It could be your own project boundaries or whatever kinds of layers you might need to orientate to an area of interest. And so once you have your area that you would like to acquire data for in here, there's a tool on the toolbar. Second button here with the, kind of the box and the arrow, get LANDFIRE data. If we click that to turn on the tool, we can now use the mouse pointer to click and drag a box. And so this would be defining an extent rectangle that we would like to download some data for. So if you drag it and then just release the mouse button, it's going to open the LFDAT download form. So I'll take a look at this form for just a second and talk about what some of the things going on here. In the upper left corner, it will show you the extent rectangle that you defined. So it will give the bounding coordinates in lat long of that rectangle that you just defined. And there is a hyperlink in the center of that that will open a Google map. And I just realized I'm not sharing. Internet Explorer anymore, so you probably don't see that.
Yeah, we just see black.
So, sorry about that, but just trust me, it's not a big deal. I mean, you know, occasionally it's handy to open that if you want to take a quick look at the high-res imagery for your area of interest. But it would just open up a browser window, zoom into that in Google Maps, and draw the box around it that you just defined. So you could just take a quick look at it in Google Maps. Then below that, we can save this extent rectangle. So if we wanted to use it later, we could give it a just type a name in here and hit save. It'll tell us that it's been saved. And now I'm just going to close this for 1 second and show you that if we look at this next drop down over where it says extent, we now have listed LFDAT webinar as a saved extent. So we've got that exact extent saved. We could come back and use it later if needed. The one that I'm looking at now, I previously saved as Missoula Blue Mountain. So I'm going to click that and save the extents and get back to the download form for this extent that I previously had downloaded some data for. There are a couple other hyperlinks here. We've got a link to some of the landfire.gov site about data notifications and data alerts. This is just kind of a reminder that Landfire posts some useful information that you might want to monitor if you're using Landfire data a lot. So it's just a quick way to get to that information. It would just open a browser window to those pages on landfire.gov. And then to the right of that, there's a section called LFDAT News. And this is kind of a real-time update thing. I can post these messages, and you'll see them as soon as they're posted. And this is kind of where how you can stay apprised of updates, especially needs to update that configuration database I mentioned. When LFDAT 2.4 for ARC-10 gets posted, there'll be a notice in here about that. And you can just double-click one of these entries. It'll describe that kind of news item we're letting you know about. Often give you a link. If it's a download page, it will give you a link. Or if it's an update to the database, it will give you some instructions on how to do that. And the dates of these entries are off here to the right. So if you're using this frequently, you can just kind of keep an eye and see, oh, there's something recent added here. Maybe I should see, you know, what kind of update there's been. Maybe I need to take some action based on that. So it just kind of keeps you apprised of those kinds of things. To download data, we have a drop-down list up here in the top right that will give us a list of layers available. These are sorted alphabetically. So it starts out with the disturbance layers here. I'm going to scroll all the way to the bottom, which gets us to the most recent data, the refresh 2008 data. So all the different layers are just listed by name, and we can check the layers that we want to download one or more layers. I'm going to go up for just a second here. There are a few layers labeled other. Those are non-landfire layers that are available from USGS. They're just related things that are sometimes useful, like different boundaries, and roads, that kind of thing. So they're not landfire data, but they're just there for convenience, things that are occasionally useful. Everything else that's not labeled other is referring to landfire data. So I previously downloaded the fuel and terrain layers for this extent we're looking at. So I'm going to go say maybe I want to get the existing vegetation layers, the type and the stand height and the canopy cover. So we can pick one or more layers, and once they're picked, selected there, you can hit request download. And at this point, the process is pretty much the same as if you were using the data distribution site from the website directly. So what you're going to get is a request summary page, a summary of what you've just requested, and it'll be a list of layers with links to download them, these buttons for download. And before we do that, I just want to point out a couple of things about using this request summary page. You're going to get a summary of the layer with a little bit of information about it. And one thing to realize here is that there's a default projection or coordinate system for all the LANDFIRE data, which is an Albers equal area projection. That's basically a continental scale projection. That's the default. You can, one option is that you could change that here, and that's one of the things that you can change through this link at the top called Modify Data Request. So I'm just going to click that, and it will open a new page here that gives us a few options that we can modify about this data request. And the first thing here at the top is the output coordinate system that we want. Standard is just that default. That would be the Albers equal area. A lot of times, people are going to want a more localized projection, like a UTM projection for the area where they're working. So you have the option here to take a best fit UTM from using either a NAT83 or a NAT27 datum. The best fit means that the server is going to look at your extent and make a choice about which UTM zone that should be in. So you can't control it specifically, but you'll get the best fit UTM for that extent. If what you wanted to do is specify a UTM zone specifically, then you probably want to just download it in the standard projection and then use LFDAT to select exactly the coordinate system that you want.
Chris, Xander, let me jump in for 1 second. I had an interesting question on the chat window. Can you use another data set that you already have in ArcMap for selecting the download extent?
You can't do that explicitly. What you can do is add your data set into ArcMap and then manually draw the rectangle to match it. There's one other possible option that I'll mention in just 1 second, but basically that's what you would have to do. So if you had polygon for project area boundary, you couldn't just send it the polygon and ask for data for that. You would have to add the polygon to ArcMap and drag a box that kind of matches the bounding box of that polygon. Okay, the other thing you get on this page is a list of actually all the layers that are available, and they're mostly not selected. I'm just going to scroll through it to find the ones that I selected, and then that's these three existing vegetation layers. What you can do here is change the raster format. So for some reason, if you don't want ArcGrid, you could request the data as a GeoTIFF or an ERDAS Imagine file. And change the raster format. It's always going to default, though, to an ArcGrid format. You could change the type of compression file that you get. In this last box here, where it says HTML, it's just the format of the metadata. And it's probably not worth ever changing, because you're always going to get HTML and XML metadata with all the downloads. And then scrolling all the way down here, one other thing you can change is the maximum size per piece, and that refers to that multi-piece download I was talking about. So what it's saying here is that if the raster exceeds 250 megabytes, it's going to split that into multiple pieces. But you could change that threshold, but it defaults to the largest, so all you could do is make it smaller. And typically you're not going to do that, so it's already defaulting to the largest size. So I didn't make any changes here. I'm just going to hit cancel. If you made changes, you hit the save changes and return to summary. I'm just going to go ahead and cancel, go back to the summary. And so just realize that modify data request has a few options there that might be useful. But the next thing would be to just start downloading by clicking the download buttons. And you're going to get a pop-up window, Internet Explorer window, that gives you some status information about the request. It'll take a few seconds to maybe several minutes to process, depending on the size of your extent. But it's going to kind of give you some feedback here about what it's doing. And I'm just going to let this one complete before we move on. It shouldn't take very long.
Chris, just so you're aware, that pop-up window is all black for us out here in virtual world.
Right. Yeah, sorry about that. I should have kept Internet Explorer shared so you can't see that. But I'm just looking at a little pop-up window that's telling me that it's extracting the data. And as soon as it's done, it gives me the save dialog that you see in Internet Explorer when you're downloading a file. And you can click Save, select a folder, and save that file. And so I just completed that. I'm done with it. And so you would just work through the list and download these. It should be really straightforward. You'll just see a little status window, and then you'll get a download prompt. And what you want to do then is save each of those zip files into a single folder usually, and let LFDAT just process that folder. So I'll stop here. I won't do all three of them, but. We'll just assume that we've kind of gone through this download process and we've saved some zip files of the layers we're interested in a particular folder. So that's pretty much it for the download form. The downloading part is really that easy. You could take as many layers as you want. You could define other extents and get more data, save it all in a folder. Now I'll come back to the toolbar and keep moving across. The one other way that you could define an extent rectangle is this next button here. You could type in the coordinates manually. So if you did have some data and you knew what the bounding coordinates were, you could enter them manually and give it a name and save that extent. I kind of guess that this is seldom used, but it's there if you did have that situation where you know what the bounding coordinates are and you'd like to enter them exactly and have an extent set up for those exact coordinates. Typically, the next thing you're going to do after you download the data is what we refer to as assembling the data. So this kind of icon of the gears here will open a form called the LANDFIRE Smart Assembler. And this is where we would pick the folder where we've downloaded the data. So we've dropped all our zip files into a folder. Do you see the Browse for Folder dialog?
Yes, I see it. Good.
Okay, good. So when I was downloading there and saving, I had a folder here that I'm navigating to called Data under LFDAT Webinar. And in there I have the zip files, the downloaded zip files for these fuel and terrain layers that are already in my ArcMap. And I also have the existing vegetation canopy cover that I downloaded just now. I just added it to there. So we've got a folder that we've dropped all these zip files into. And we really don't care how many there are. We don't care if some of them are multi-piece downloads because it's a large extent. And it doesn't really matter that much if they're in multiple different extents. So we select the folder that has our zip files, and really that folder should only contain those downloaded zip files. And then the next thing we pick is an output location, where we want to write that data out. And in this dialog, you can even create that folder if you need to. It should ideally be empty in the beginning. So I did it before to one called out. I'm going to make a new folder here, and I'm going to call it out2. So we're telling it the location where we want to write the output grids. The next thing we can do is choose the raster file type. It's going to default to the Esri Arc Grid. We could write them as Imagin files or GeoTIFF, so you can do some format conversion here if needed. If we want to reproject it to a different coordinate system, we can select that, and you just have the usual ArcMap selector for picking a coordinate system. So if we wanted to go to UTM, we could navigate to UTM and probably NAT83, and my extent was in zone 11, I believe. So here we're telling it we no longer want the standard default LANDFIRE projection. We want to write it out, reproject it to UTM zone 11. And that's it. Here we hit assemble data. It's going to start operating on those zip files and give us a bunch of messages about what it's doing. It's going to unzip each one of them. It's going to go through the reproject operation. It's going to name them. And we told them we just wanted to keep them as Arc Grid, so it's going to write them out in Arc Grid format. And it should not take very long. If you had a much larger extent, you know, this processing could take several minutes. But for those, I had 8 fuel and terrain layers, and I added the existing vegetation cover layer. So that was processing those 9 layers, but this is a pretty small extent, and it did it, you can see, in under a minute. And we get some status messages here. At that point, it's done. You have the data ready to add to ArcMap. And the next button here is, you don't have to use this next button. You could just use the usual ArcMap add data button and go add that data. But we do have a customized add data button on the toolbar. And it's really just kind of a convenience function, because all of these LANDFIRE layers, at least the thematic layers, have color maps with them so that you get a good symbology when you add it. But ArcMap doesn't always like default to that when you first add it. Sometimes you have to go into the symbology and kind of tell it to use the color map and stuff like that. So this really just saves you a few clicks around to get the symbology set up right. And also when you hit this add data button, it'll default to the folder that you just last wrote the output to. So I wrote to this out2 folder, and now these are all the layers I have. And this is how LFDAT named them. This underscore 1 at the end is just to make them unique if we did have multiple different extents in here, so that we have the same layer but 2 different spatial extents. The second extent would get an underscore 2 just to keep them separate and give them unique names. But we've got all the layers here, so I'm just going to add maybe I just downloaded the existing vegetation canopy cover layer, so I'll add that. And this customized add data button lets you pick the field in there that you would like to display in the legend. So I'm going to display the actual class names and add the layer. And then you see it switch it up, it switched to the color map. By default, when ArcMap brought it in, it wasn't using the color map. So we go ahead and set up the symbology to use the color map. And then in the legend over here, we've got the actual class names instead of just the value field that ArcMap would have defaulted to. So it just saves you a few clicks in setting up the symbology. That is about it for the core functionality. The next thing that I'll mention here is some of these kind of ancillary utilities that we've included, and that's this Swiss Army knife icon on the toolbar. And so there are things here like build the LCP file, and there's an interface for doing that. It's pretty straightforward. It lets us pick each of the layers that make up an LCP file, and if we already have them in ArcMap, they'll show up in these drop downs. So I can pick my elevation, I can pick my slope, we need the aspect, we need the fuel model layer, which we have as a, that's an F40. We have a canopy cover layer. Now, if they weren't already in ArcMap, we could use the other button next to it, which would just let us browse the file system and find the layer, so these don't have to already be in ArcMap. We would need the canopy height layer, the forest canopy height layer. Canopy bulk density is the CBD. And, oops, I'm sorry, that was the canopy base height. And the canopy bulk density. And then we also have to tell it what units these are in. These default to the LANDFIRE units that the data come in. If some of these layers were your own layers and happen to be in different units, you have the option to change units. We can change the extent. All these layers do not have to be the same extent, and it'll default to whatever the elevation raster extent was. We can change that. It gives us an interface to do that. We can drag a box on here. We can pick a different layer that we want to use to define the extent, so you have some options there. You have to tell it the latitude of where this is, but it populates that for you based on where the layers are spatially. And then we just give it a name. I'll put test. Hit build LCP. It'll give us some progress, and it'll run through and write out the LCP file. Again, this may have involved downloading data in the hours projection, but you want your LCP to be in a local UTM projection, so you could have reprojected all the data during the assembly and then gone through and produced your LCP file this way.
Chris, we had a question about coordinate systems and reprojecting. James was asking why one would want to reproject data coming in. You want to address that now?
Because I'm about done here. I'm not going to demo any of these other utilities other than point out that they're there. That's a really good question. So when you look at these really large-scale projections, like the Albers Equal Area, it's a continental projection. You know, the deal with projections is you're taking something that's three-dimensional and flattening it into a two-dimensional space, which results in distortion. And when you look at that, you know, one parameter of a coordinate system is the central meridian. For a projection that's being intended to use across, say, the entire United States, there's a central meridian right about the middle of the United States. Well, as you move away from that, and so you get far east or far west, there's distortion in things like direction. And what you'll find is that if you get pretty far west, like where we are here in Montana, or you know, all the way across the west, true north is no longer straight up on the map. It's actually distorted by several degrees. So the map north or grid north is no longer aligned closely to true north, due to the distortion of the projection, and it's designed to be a very large area projection. And so that can be a problem in fire modeling, because when you bring in weather data and you have things like wind vectors, your spatial data may no longer be really lined up exactly with your wind vector data in terms of those azimuths, because the map projection isn't a true north-up projection. So the reason for going to a local projection like UTM, the UTM zones, I think, are 6 degrees across, 6 degrees longitude across? So it's just much more localized to the area that you're in, so that when you look at the map, and which is grid north looking straight up, it's really close to true north. You're never off by more than a degree or two. You just don't have that distortion when you go to a more localized projection. There's an article and some information on the LANDFIRE website about that, but it can be important in fire behavior modeling when you're bringing in, say, wind data that assumes the azimuths and all are kind of lining up, but you've got a projection, a really large area projection that's distorting your directions, and north is not no longer straight up. So a lot of people will end up wanting to work in UTM for that reason. I mean, the only other reason would be that a lot of people already have their local data in some local projection like UTM, and they'd like to make the data match and have everything in the same coordinate system, even if they're not doing this fire modeling. But that fire modeling aspect of it can be pretty important in some cases. Hopefully that helps. Projection issues are always really complicated. It's always hard for me to get my mind around all the different projection issues. So just a couple other things here. There is a reproject raster. It's just a standalone reproject utility, probably seldom used. ArcMap has one built in. We just have one there. And then the other thing that might be especially useful is if you have an LCP file, but you wanted to get it back to the original ARC grids and use them in ArcMap and stuff, you could point this to the LCP file and have it extract those individual layers and write them out as individual grids. So that's sometimes a helpful function. And then the one other thing in this little toolbox here is we do have this utility to attach an